Simon & Schuster Audio presents Forbidden City, Book 3 of City Spies by James Ponti. Read by Lisa Flanagan. For Courtney and Grayson. March 5th, 2022. Congratulations on making our family bigger and better. I love you more than words can ever express. Chapter 1. Billionaires Row. It was dark, and as Paris looked out at the traffic, he caught a glimpse of his own reflection in the window. There was nothing remarkable about his face. No feature or quirk someone would notice or remember. He'd been born in Rwanda, grew up in Paris, lived in Scotland, and was now in London. And in each of those locations, he'd learned to blend in and disappear. This was an important quality because Paris wasn't just a schoolboy. He was also a spy. Blending in was essential. Unlike spies in movies whose modes of transportation ranged from jetpacks and mini-submarines to bulletproof Aston Martins tricked out with rocket launchers, he was headed to his latest mission on a city bus. The number 70 to South Kensington, to be precise. That was the problem with being undercover and underage. You always needed somebody else to give you a ride.
"This is pathetic," he said, turning to Kat, who was sitting next to him. "Absolutely pathetic."
"What is?" she asked.
He looked around to make sure no one was listening and then leaned in to whisper,
"We're about to break into one of the most expensive homes in London to steal a priceless work of art. And our getaway car is a bright red double-decker bus that does a max speed of 5 miles an hour."
Kat laughed, which only frustrated him.
"First of all, we're not stealing it. We're returning it," she answered in an equally hushed tone. "Or have you forgotten about the little treasure that's been sewn into the lining of your jacket? Second, once you've put it back, why would anyone bother to chase us? Logic dictates that our getaway vehicle is irrelevant."
He nodded reluctantly and admitted,
"Okay, you may have a point there."
"Of course I do," she replied. "Your problem is that you think being a spy is like being in an action movie."
"It's not?"
"No, it's like eating in the lunch hall at school."
"How do you figure that?" Paris asked.
"You pretend you belong and hope nobody notices you while you figure things out," she said. "Not to mention, there's a decent chance the food's been poisoned."
He chuckled and saw that they were nearing their stop at Notting Hill Gate.
"Finally, this is us."
He stood up to leave, but she stayed put, blocking his way.
"I'm not moving until you say it," she said firmly.
Paris was the alpha, which meant he was in charge now that they were in the field. It also meant he was the one who was supposed to say the phrase that officially started the mission. It was as much a good luck ritual as it was an operational command.
"Here?" he replied. "On the bus?"
"Don't knock the bus," she said. "James Bond was named after one just like this."
"What do you mean?"
"When Ian Fleming was writing the first Bond book, he lived out in Kent and had to ride the bus back and forth to London," she explained.
"And?"
he replied, not getting the connection.
"The bus from Kent to Victoria was number 007.
"You're joking," he said.
"No, that's where he got the name. And if the bus is good enough for Ian and James, it's good enough for you and me."
"Well, if you put it that way."
He flashed a sly smile and said,
"This operation is hot. We are a go."
Paris and Kat were part of the City Spies, an experimental team of 5 undercover agents aged 12 to 15, who MI6 used when they had a mission in which adult agents would stand out. In this instance, they were about to crash the Sweet 16 party of a London socialite named Tabitha Banks. The British Secret Intelligence Service wasn't really interested in the birthday girl, but they were fascinated by her father. Reginald Banks was a multi-billionaire whose business dealings sometimes involved nefarious underworld characters and shadowy figures from foreign intelligence agencies. MI6 desperately needed to get an agent into his home, and this party offered a rare opportunity to access the highly secure mansion located on Kensington Palace Gardens, one of the most exclusive neighborhoods in the world.
Testing comms, 1, 2, 3, Paris said as they walked away from the bus stop. Can you hear me?
He was using a covert communication device that looked like an everyday earbud to speak with team members monitoring the situation from a nearby safe house.
Roger that. We hear you loud and clear, replied Mother, the MI6 agent in charge of the team.
How about me?
Asked Kat, testing her comms device.
Perfect, Mother replied. We are ready to rock and roll. We've got Brooklyn on the computer and Sydney is...
There was a pause as Mother turned to Sydney.
What exactly are you doing?
She gave him a look as if the answer were obvious.
I'm standing by just in case, she replied.
We have Sydney standing by just in case, Mother continued. Although technically she's pacing more than standing.
Relax, Sid, Paris said confidently.
We've got this. She's not pacing because she's worried about the mission, Brooklyn pointed out. She's pacing because she's jealous that she's not the one doing it. This brought a round of laughs, and Sydney didn't even bother to disagree. She always wanted to be the alpha and hated it when she missed out on the action.
Just remember that I'm here if you need me, she offered, ready and willing.
Good to know, said Paris.
We've almost reached the guard gate at the end of the street, Kat said. Any last words of wisdom?
Yes, answered Mother,
who cleared his throat and paused dramatically before saying, This mission is fraught, so don't get caught. He liked to use rhyming couplets nicknamed Motherisms to remind the team of important elements of spycraft. This one left Kat and Paris completely uninspired.
Seriously?
Kat replied.
Is that the best you've got? Asked Paris.
Well, I could have pointed out that if you get caught, it will not only involve the Metropolitan Police, but quite likely the Prime Minister, the head of MI6, the Foreign Secretary, the French Ambassador, and the President of Nepal, said Mother. But I didn't want to overwhelm you, and it's exceedingly difficult to make all that rhyme.
Fair points all, said Paris.
Oh, and there's one more thing, Paris, interjected Brooklyn.
What's that? He replied.
Try to remember that your microphone is very sensitive, she said.
Okay, but why am I remembering that?
Because it will blow out our headsets if you squeal too loudly when KB5 take the stage, she said, eliciting more laughter.
You are so very funny, Paris replied. Trust me, if I scream, it will be because I'm in musical agony, although calling what they do music is an offense to everyone from Beethoven to the Beatles.
KB5 was a British boy band whose heartthrob members had their pictures plastered on bedroom walls around the globe. Despite Paris's opinion of their musical ability, they regularly performed in sold-out arenas bursting with screaming fans. Tonight, however, they were playing a private concert for Tabitha's birthday. This was an advantage of having Reginald Banks for a father. Not only was he one of the richest people in the United Kingdom, but he also created KB5 and owned the record label that produced their albums.
I like their music, Sydney offered. It's not too late if you want to swap roles.
I would gladly do so, said Paris. If only Australia had built their embassy on Kensington Palace Gardens.
Nicknamed Billionaires Row, Kensington Palace Gardens was home to business tycoons, royal family members, foreign embassies, and the residences of several ambassadors. It was a half mile long and protected at both ends by guard gates with armed police officers. For any outsiders who still didn't get the hint, there were even signs that read, No photography. Sir Reg, as he was known in the tabloids, couldn't just hold a concert in his backyard without the approval of his very powerful and extremely private neighbors. So he'd come up with a brilliant solution and opened up the celebration to all the young people who lived on the street. Since no parent wanted to face the wrath of a furious teen or tween who'd missed out on the party of the decade, permission was granted. Invitations were also extended to the children of embassy workers, which is when MI6 saw an opportunity. As good fortune would have it, Kensington Palace Gardens was home to the ambassador of France and the embassy of Nepal, Paris and Kat's home countries. Some favors were called in, and their names were added to the guest list. For Paris, this meant swapping identities yet again, something he'd done countless times during his 5 years with MI6. As he approached the guardhouse, he flipped a mental switch and became someone else, like an actor stepping onto the stage in a West End play.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.